Hey, good morning, good morning. My name is Jonathan, and I just want to welcome you right now here to Online Church. Right now, we're actually here at the Elks, as you can see, and we're getting ready for our church on the lawn, and I'm super excited for that, and I'm super excited for today's service, and I know that today is the day that the Lord has made, and let us rejoice in it. Let us rejoice in this time, and we're going to get into some worship, but before we do that, right there where you're at, just go ahead and start sharing this, comment, let us know where you're at, and what you're doing, and how you're praising God with us this morning, and just share and this so that people can know. Let us use our evangelistic tools and share this, and let somebody else know that the love of God is there. And right there where you're at, we're just about to get into worship, and it's going to be special. So I hope you can engage with us and be permalicious, right? And engage with us in our worship and our experience. Enjoy.
Our God is great and glorious. must first begin in me. I surrender so your world can be changed. The change I want to see must first begin in me. I surrender, yeah, so your world can be changed.
The change I want to see
must first begin.
Say what you say.
Fill me up.
Fill me up.
I wanna say what you say.
closer than before, closer than I've ever been.
I've been longing for you, flame. Drown under the shadow of the Almighty God. Wrap me in your arms, oh God. Nothing like your presence, oh God. Oh, wrap me in your arms.
You could really feel the presence of God even through these videos. You know, there's a special anointing that happens when you just welcome God into your home, even through this time of worship. And even with that, we're gonna get into this time and we're gonna let you guys know that we're here 24 hours for your prayer requests. We may not know what's going on, God knows what's going on with you guys, but we have a place where you can come and just share your prayer requests with us, and you can share that at info@cityviewworship.com, and there's people there waiting so that we can pray for you, for your family, for whatever going on, whatever situation you have. You can go ahead and send that in, and people are there waiting for you to see miracles take place in your life. Right now, we also want to get into another time of worship, and that is with our tithes and our offering. You know, I really enjoy this time because it's something that tangible that I can do to show God that I love him and that I worship him with everything and I trust him. And there's so many ways to give. You know, my favorite and the one that I use and probably most of us use is Easy Tithe. You can use that, download the app. It'll tell you all the steps you need to take. You could also mail it at P.O. Box 547, Port Hueneme, California, 93044. And you could also text, which is another amazing way, fast way. All you gotta do is text the word GIVE to the number 1-805-221220. And those are great ways to give and just show tangible ways that we trust God. Amen. And right now with that, we have some special news coming from our very own Sister V. So I'm gonna hand it over to you, Sister V.
Thank you, Jonathan. And good morning, City View Worship. I hope and I pray that everybody's doing wonderful, that everybody's blessed, that everybody's doing well. I just want to take this time to personally invite you all out for this weekend, a weekend at City View Worship. We are so excited for this weekend. I'll begin with Saturday, September the 19th. This Saturday, September the 19th, we are going to begin the weekend with a 50th birthday party for my husband, which it's called Happy 50th Birthday Jamboy. Jamboy was his original DJ name, and so we wanted just to have a good time. We're going to have a fun time, fellowship, music. We are asking everybody to wear your mask. We're asking everybody to bring your chair, sit around your car. And for those of you that maybe feel like, do I bring my kids? Bring your kids. Also, what if I don't want to get off my car? You don't have to get off your car. Food will be served to you. Food is going to be delivered to your car. We're going to be having delicious carne asada tacos from none other than Pastor Joe and also Brother Agustin, which is Yesenia's father. They'll be cooking up some delicious tacos and a bottle of water. And it's for the whole family. It's going to be a fun time, a fellowship of games, and it's just going to be fun. And so I really ask you to be there. You'll be hearing a little bit more details in a bit, but I want to say it's for the family, for everybody. And then we turn the page to Sunday, September the 20th, and that's what I'm so excited for as well. It's Church on the Lawn, and I cannot remember when's the last time we gathered together as a church family and just worship the Lord together. And so I'm so excited. This is going to be, it has been strategically planned. There's going to be no special service for the children, but they are going to feel so special. The children's team, a Kidsland team, is working hard to make every child feel special. They'll be getting special little treats on that day. And so bring your blanket, bring your chairs, however you want to worship the Lord. We want you there. Again, if you're not comfortable of getting off your car, you don't have to get off your car. We're going to have designated parking spaces for those of you that don't feel comfortable and want to stay in your car. That's both at the birthday party and at Church on the Lawn. So again, I remind you, don't miss out. That's this weekend, Saturday and Sunday, a weekend at City View Worship. I love you, church family, and I can't wait to see you. God bless you.
Hey there, City View Worship. We have a big special announcement. Our very own Pastor Fernie Franco's 50th birthday is just around the corner. Now, we'll be celebrating DJ Jamboy, which he was known back in the day, on September 19th from 1 to 4 at the Elk Lodge. Now, the celebration is a tailgate parade. So as you parade on through celebrating the birthday boy, you're going to be guided to a station where you can park your car and feel free to bring chairs to sit around your car.
So I know everybody loves to eat and everybody loves tacos. So we will be having Asada Street Tacos from the famous Fatty's Food Truck. You guys are also more than welcome to bring your own snacks and drink as well.
And what more to add to the celebration and fun but games? We got a couple games going on. We got cornhole. We have horseshoe. We're also going to be doing a basketball shoot-off. It's going to be a $5 entry fee, and the winner is going to take it all. But of course, you guys can feel free to bring your own, whether it's dominoes, cards, whatever it is. We just want you guys to have some fun.
We will also be following CDC guidelines by maintaining 6 feet apart, have a mask on hand, and we will be having sanitizing stations. So come on through and help us celebrate.
Where you at, DJ John Boy? Got DJ Chino right here in the house.
Hi, Pastor Fernie and CityView Church. This is Pastor David from South Life Church in Holland. I just want to greet you guys and encourage you guys to continue to do the work of God. I know Pastor Fernie for a long time. We've been serving the Lord for a very long time together. And you know, it is a joy to see how God is using you, Pastor, and you guys as a church to reach your community. I tell you, there is something big about to happen over there in Oxnard. I know that you guys are exciting and expecting great things. But you know what? Keep pushing forward. Keep believing God and see the wonders of God being manifest in your church and in your city. I give you greetings from us here, from Holland, and also from my wife. Also greetings to your wife, Sister V, and God bless you all. See you.
Hey, Pastor Fernie and Veronica in City View Worship Church in Oxnard, California. My name is Sebastian van Wessum, lead pastor, Celebration Church in the Netherlands. And I'm so thankful for the connection that we made last year at South Life Conference all the way in Heerlen, the Netherlands. And I just love, you know, just being globally connected with great churches like yours. And I'm believing big things for City View Worship Church in the future as you guys just take a hold of this brand new building. And I know God's on the move. You know, Corona or not, doesn't really matter. God's in control. Jesus is in control. He's still Lord. He's still King. And I just pray God's blessing over your church. and looking forward to what God's going to do. So I'm believing for a revival in California and Oxnard as well, in your town, in your city. May God bless you, and may God bless your team. May God bless you, Pastor Fernie and Veronica. And I can't wait to see you in person very soon again. See you soon.
If you church, this is Pastor Regulio, all the way from Holland, the Netherlands, from the beautiful city of Rotterdam, from the Alpha Omega Ministries. Greetings also from my wife as Pastor Fernie. I also want to greet you and your wife and your beautiful family, of course. You really had a great time when you were here in Holland. You're a good friend of mine, and I really appreciate you, and you're a great man of God. Now, listen, church, I really want to encourage you. We're living in crazy, crazy, crazy times right now. When we see what's happening around us, now, I believe that Jesus Christ is coming soon. Let's continue to preach the gospel, continue to reach the lost. Let's be encouraging each other, build each other up, pray together, do the work what God has called us to do, and you play a very important role. Let's not be comfortable, but this is a time of action. So church, I really want to encourage you, and I want to say you, God bless you, and I really hope to worship together with you one day.
Hola, Señor bendiga. Mi nombre es Luis Alcido, soy pastor de la iglesia Centro de Fe Phoenix en la ciudad de Phoenix, Arizona. Conozco a Pastor Fernie ya por algunos años, un gran amigo, un gran modelo en mi vida, no solamente ministerial, sino personal. Conozco a él y a su esposa, los cuales han sido grandes modelos en nuestra vida. Yo sé que estos tiempos son tiempos difíciles, tiempos en los cuales la iglesia en general está siendo golpeada, no solamente en California, en Arizona, sino en todo el país y en todo el mundo. Y son estos tiempos en los cuales reconocemos que hay líderes como Pastor Fernie Franco que se sostienen, que se mantienen. Y yo creo que este tiempo Dios va a estar haciendo grandes cosas en su iglesia. Conozco el liderazgo del Pastor Fernie Franco y yo sé que él ha sabido salir en tiempos difíciles adelante. Es una de las razones por las que estamos aquí nosotros como Centro de Fe Phoenix, porque recibimos mucho apoyo de su pastor. Y tienen un gran pastor, lo cual le doy gracias a Dios por haberlo puesto enfrente de mi vida. En estos tiempos, que el Señor les bendiga mucho, sigan adelante, la unidad va a ser muy importante. Busquemos a Dios con todo nuestro corazón, y si Dios está con nosotros, ¿quién contra nosotros? Dios bendiga a Pastor Fernie Franco, su familia, su ministerio y toda su vida en general. Dios me lo bendiga mucho, cuídese. Y ya sabes, siempre tendrán un amigo aquí en Phoenix y una iglesia hermana, Centro de Fe Phoenix.
Wow, thank you, Sister V's, for such the exciting news that we have for that City View weekend and all that's going on. And to all the pastors and all those that are sharing love at this time and the greetings that they have for our church. Those are great words of encouragement for us, and I hope you can take that in. But right now we're going to go over to Pastor Fernie at Statham Blvd, where he's going to be giving us the Word of God. Hope you can tune in and open your hearts.
Hey, thank you, Jonathan. That was, you did a great job emceeing today, by the way. And also, I'm so excited for this coming weekend at CVW. I appreciate what you guys are doing for my birthday. I don't know the details, but I just want to say thank you to my wife and everybody who is part of putting this together. I'm looking forward to this coming weekend just to celebrate together as a church there on the lawn at the Elks Lodge. I'm looking forward to it. And so again, thank you guys so much for everything that you're doing. Well, today is Sunday, September the 13th, and I'm right here at our Statham property, as Jonathan mentioned, and I'm in the city room. I was here about a month ago. I'm back here again today, and I am excited to speak this message to you guys. This is a title that God gave me. It's nothing fancy, but the title of this message is just called 10. Then and now. 10. 10 what? The Ten Commandments. I can't remember the last time I heard a sermon preach on the Ten Commandments. I think we take it for granted, but there's something powerful when a law is instituted. You know, a law is put in place for a reason. A law is not there to control us. It's there to care for us. A law is not there to have power over us. It's there to protect us. A law is not there to loot over our lives, but it is to love into our lives. And so laws are put in place for a reason. And these Ten Commandments pretty much are basically 10 laws that God gave to his servant Moses, which, as we know, was the leader of the Israelites. But in Exodus chapter 20, verses 1 and 2, the Bible says, "Now God spoke all these words, saying, I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage." I love that reminder there, out of the house of bondage. All of us come from a house of bondage somewhere in our past. Some of us find ourselves still in a house of bondage. Well, I'm here to say that God can take you out of a house of bondage. If he's done it before, he could do it again. And so remember, the past is good in a sense to look behind you to take note of what God did before. And so if God delivered you before, he can deliver you again. But these things, God actually, when he took the Israelites out of the land of Egypt or the house of bondage, he gave what I call the 10, what the Bible calls the 10 commandments. And so God lays out the 10 right after this verse that I read to you, these two verses. And the 10, then and now, I want to try to bring the 10 commandments relevant to where we're at today, as in regards to the new covenant that we are in today after Jesus has come into this world. As I said, the Israelites had been delivered from the slavery in Egypt, and it didn't take long for them to forget what God had done for them. Moses sought God's help. You know, leaders, that's what they do, is that they go to God. God is the greatest revealer when it comes to problem solving. And so Moses ran to God. He went up to the Mount Sinai, and God himself engraved these 10 commandments on two tablets of stone. God's finger himself. What most people don't know is these 10 commandments are broken down into two different categories. Number one, the first group of commandments laid out the rules to protect the harmony between God and people. The second part of commandments was designed to maintain the respect between people. Now, when you think about those commandments, those are good commandments. They're divided up into two groups that will help us get through life: our relationship with God and our relationship with people. That's basically what all these 10 commandments break down into. Selfishness in the Israelites, with the Israelites, risked the community's survival. Listen to that closely. We always put ourselves and the people that are in our household at risk when we fall into this bad character flaw called selfishness. And when a person broke a commandment in the Old Testament, he had to pay a penalty. He had to repay the person he had injured. And he had to make a sacrifice to restore peace with God. This is how it was then. Over the next 1400 years, the law was often forgotten. And the worship of the one true God was abandoned. The Lord said that someday he was going to send a Savior, and he would have a new covenant with his people, and the law would be written on their hearts, not just on stone tablets. Wow. I want you to remember that, because this is how we're going to eventually close this talk, that the commandments would be written on their hearts, not just on stone tablets. So God did. He sent the Savior that we all know. He's in our hearts, most of us. His name is Jesus Christ. And he sent him here to this globe to live a perfect life and to take the penalty for our sin through his death on the cross. Somebody say, thank you, Jesus, for that. And because through his sacrifice, he made us perfect in God's eyes through faith. So Jesus came to fulfill the law. Thank you, Jesus, for doing that. And he taught that the spirit of the law was as important as the letter of the law. The spirit of the law was just as important as the letter of the law. So let's talk about them. Let's skim through these really quick, okay? The 10. Number one, no other God. That's the first commandment. No other God. Exodus chapter 20, verse 3, it says, "Do not worship any God except me." God is a jealous God. Remember, He paid a price for your soul. He wants you for Himself. And so the first commandment is no other God. There is always a principle that hangs from the laws of God. And I'm going to give you a principle to each one of these laws. So when we look at this first law, no other God, the principle would be God is the creator and Lord of the universe. He deserves our first loyalty. Our first loyalty goes to God. What does it mean? Well, God should always be our highest priority over everyone and everything. A God is anything a person allows to rule his or her life. Now, I know that today you possibly think, I don't worship any other God. And it's because probably the way we're thinking. But in reality, if we do a good inspection in our lives, there probably and possibly is another God that has taken the place of our Father who's in heaven. And only you and God would know that. But anything that comes before God, you know, I can name some stuff, some superstitions, horoscopes, money, possessions, careers, family, friends, addictions, fame, power, even the church. Anything that comes before God. So in the Bible, I guess I can look at Abraham. Abraham proved that God was his first priority by being willing to give up his own son. Daniel and his three friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, risked their lives because they remained devoted to the Lord as their only God. What does Jesus teach about this law? When Jesus was asked, which is the greatest commandment in the law? Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your mind. This is the first and the greatest commandment. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, no one can serve two masters. Either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. So number one, no other gods, the 10. What would number two be? Number two is no idols. Exodus chapter 20, verse 4, it says, you shall not make for yourself an image. That's talking about idols. What's the principle here? The principle is God is spirit and is bigger and more powerful than any representation. What does it mean? Put our faith in God only. Idol worship is worshiping or serving anything in the place of God. So, you know, there's a difference between the first commandment and the second commandment. The first commandment is there's another God in position. But the second commandment is now you're worshiping that God. It's an idol now. You're worshiping that God. Idolatry can also include the worship of the true God through an idol. Here's what I mean by that. See, when we worship something that we can see and we could touch or we can control, then we miss the power or the splendor of God. And that's why it's easy to fall into idolatry, because that's tangible stuff. You know, there's people today in religion, they have actual idols. They pray to idols. They pray to statues. And it's easier because you can feel it, you can touch it, you can see it. But when we put our faith into what we can see, feel, and touch, then it removes the majesty of God, the splendor of God. So that's what this means. And so in the Bible, the prophet Habakkuk, he wrote that idolatry is when a man trusts his own creation more than he trusts God. While Moses was receiving the Ten Commandments, I want you to picture this. While Moses was up on the Mount Sinai, while he was receiving the Ten Commandments, the Israelites created a golden calf, bowed down, and sacrificed offerings to it. Now tell me God wasn't speaking to the leader. Tell me God didn't know what he's doing. While God was writing down these Ten Commandments, the Israelites were down there already creating these idols and worshiping a golden calf. What did Jesus teach about it? Jesus said, don't store up for yourself treasures here on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. See, God gives many people the gift of craftsmanship and the abilities to make beautiful images. As a matter of fact, God encouraged his people in artwork and etc. So to sculpt, paint, or design something can bring glory to God, but yet God is spirit and cannot be represented by any images crafted by human hands. In the tabernacle, remember this, remember in the tabernacle, it contained furniture overlaid with bronze and gold. It had a gold lampstand in there. The Ark of the Covenant was overlaid with gold. However, these items in the tabernacle were not worshipped and turned into idols. God was kept on the platform of the tabernacle, not idols. That's for somebody today. Keep God on the platform. Don't replace him with idols. The 10, number 3, do not misuse God's name. That's the third commandment. Exodus chapter 20, verse 7, you shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God. What's the principle here? God's name is holy, powerful, and glorious. What does it mean? God's name should be treated with respect. As God's creation, everything a person says and does should be done in order to praise and glorify God. Now, I know this is old school, but listen, I'm preaching from the Old Testament. I'm preaching from the Ten Commandments. You can't get more old school than this. But I'm sharing with you what the Old Testament had to say about it, and then I'm sharing with you what Jesus had to say about it. But what does it mean? It means that. What I just said is God's name should be treated with respect. To take his name in vain violates God's nature. In the Bible, in the Old Testament, when a man blasphemed the name of God with a curse, you know what happened? In Leviticus, it says that the Lord commanded that he be taken outside the camp and be put to death by way of stoning. That's when somebody misused God's name. Jesus was accused of blasphemy because he claimed to be God. That's why that's what they had against Jesus. It wasn't his miracles. It wasn't anything else. The law supposedly that he broke was that he blasphemed the name of God by saying that he was God and that he claimed to be God. So Jesus is teaching about this third commandment. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, do not swear at all, either by heaven, for it is God's throne, or by earth, for it is his footstool. Jesus said, every sin and blasphemy will be forgiven by him. But the blasphemy against the Spirit will not be forgiven. But I tell you that men will have to give an account on the day of judgment for every careless word that they have spoken. That's what Jesus said, not Pastor Fernie. Jesus said to begin praying with our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Holy is your name. Jews and Jewish scribes would go to great measures in order to avoid saying or writing the Lord's name for fear of blasphemy. Man, this is old school respect here, that scribes would go out of their way to not have to even write down the name of God because they were afraid that they would be held accountable for blasphemy. Wow, if we show respect for the names of our mothers, teachers, doctors, and pastors, how much more we need to respect the name of our sovereign God. Let me tell you this right now. If somebody talked about your mother, I'm sure you would take that personally. I'm sure you would stand up and want to roll up your sleeves and just make a fist. I don't care if you're a man or a woman, but when somebody talks about your mother or somebody talks about your kid, you don't take that lightly. So why is it that we take lightly by misusing the name of God? Think about that for a second. The 10, number 4. Fourth commandment, rest on the Sabbath. Exodus chapter 20, verse 8 says, remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. The principle here is God values rest, spiritual refreshment, and time for his people to set aside a day of worshiping him. This is what the Sabbath is all about. What does it mean? Well, God knew how to preserve his people by ordering the gift of rest for them. Because sometimes we won't take the rest on our own, but God said, I'm going to have to command that you rest. because he knew that's the only way he would be able to preserve our lives. And so without rest, a person becomes useless. Without spiritual refreshment, we can have rested bodies, but we'll have unrested minds. So in the Bible, the Sabbath was ordained in creation by God himself. And if you didn't abide by the day of Sabbath, then you would be prescribed punishment of death for working on the Sabbath. So this is important. Jesus taught about it. You know, one day Jesus was healing people on the Sabbath, and a synagogue ruler was opposed to what Jesus was doing. And Jesus rebuked him, and he said, "It is acceptable to have mercy on someone on the Sabbath, even if it may appear to violate the Sabbath." See, what Jesus was declaring here is that a person may do good on the Sabbath day. Now, I get this question a lot. Pastor, what is a Sabbath? Is it Saturday or Sunday? You know, not to have a doctrinal debate, but I'll tell you what my perspective is on it. But sometimes we could get so lost in a debate, we forget what the message is in the scripture. And we get so caught up on the theology of it that we forget about, or we don't pay attention to the point of it. And so, okay, if you want to talk about the theology of what day is the Sabbath, then I'll say to you this. In the Old Testament, it was different from the Sabbath that we are in today with the New Testament church and where we're at today as a church universal. In the Old Testament, the Sabbath was observed on Saturday, the seventh day of the week, because God rested on the seventh day after creating the universe. But Jesus rose from the dead on Sunday morning, the first day of the week. Through his death and resurrection, he instituted a new creation, thus making Sunday the Lord's day. You'll find it in Galatians chapter 6, verse 14 through 16. So the fourth commandment, hey, yes, the Sabbath, honor it. Take that gift that God has given you. Number five, the fifth commandment, honor your parents. Now, this is going to be good. Don't log out now. This is going to be good. Honor your parents. Exodus chapter 20, verse 12. It says it right there. Honor your father and your mother. What's the principle here? Well, God wants all people to respect and honor those that he's placed in authority. And your parents are those people. What does this mean? Treat parents with respect, no matter what situation or no matter what the situation may be. Because I get this a lot too. See, most parents made great sacrifices to bring up their children. Now, I don't know, maybe close to a year ago or so, I signed up for, what is that website where you're able to dig up your past, your relatives and all of that. You guys know what I'm talking about. Ancestry.com. So I signed up for that, and I was able to track down my great-great-great-grandparents. You know, really, you know, my family comes from Spain and Mexico. But somebody behind me that is buried under the underground right now paid a price so that way I could be born here in this beautiful country called the United States of America. But the point I'm trying to make is somebody, our parents, our great-grandparents, our great-great-grandparents, they sacrificed a lot so you can be where you're at today, so you can have what you have today, so you can live where you live today, so you can be who you are today. And so when God says honor your parents, I mean, let's think beyond just our parents, but let's think about our grandparents, our great-grandparents, and even further back than that, than what I just mentioned. But we need to honor them because they paid a price. Now, I know what some of you are thinking right now is, what if I didn't have good parents? What if boundary lines were crossed with my parents and I? I'll give you my opinion about that right now, but let's talk a little bit about this in the Bible. After the flood, Noah became drunk, and his son's name was Ham, His son made fun of him because of his irresponsibility. And even though Noah was irresponsible, Ham made fun of him, but his two other brothers, Ham's two other brothers, did not, because they honored their dad. Ham was cursed in his life because he dishonored his father, while his two other brothers, the Bible says, were blessed because they gave their dad honor. Now, in some cases, fathers and mothers are dishonorable and have caused pain and grief to their children. But even in these cases, when parents may not deserve it, God expects us to honor them for God's sake, not so much just for our parents. Jesus taught it. He taught it with his life when he honored and he respected his parents by obeying them while he grew up. And he showed us even furthermore how he provided care for his mom once he was gone. He made sure that his mom was going to be looked after when he had died. Number six, do not murder. Now I'm getting into the second group of commandments, where it has to do with the laws of us and people. The first five laws I just mentioned had to do with us and God. But now let's talk about you and people, you and your friends, you and your family, you and your coworkers, you and your acquaintances, you and just people in general that maybe you have never met before. But this is how we have to and should behave with people in our lives, around our lives, that has come into our lives. Do not murder. Number six, he says in Exodus 20, verse 13, you shall not kill. What's the principle here? God created human life and he holds it sacred. What does this mean? God created human beings in his own image. To take someone's life into one's own hands is to destroy the image of God. Now, here's a question I get a lot as well. You know, the Hebrew word for this word, kill, is the word that is pronounced ratash, which is used in this commandment for the word murder. So this contrasts the prohibition with other forms of killing, such as war, self-defense, and even the killing of animals. The question I get often is, or I shouldn't say often, but I've gotten it asked before. They said, hey, Pastor, the Bible says do not kill. Then aren't we killing animals so we can eat? Well, that word kill in the Ten Commandments does not mean the same word as kill when animal sacrifices were sacrificed unto God. And not only that, but when God made us Lord over the earth, sort of sense, to rule the earth. And so he provided food for us by way of animals. But this is in reference to killing of the human life. This commandment is in the context of unlawful killing resulting in blood guilt. If you want to know more about that, study the book of Numbers. But in the Bible says that God hates and detests hands that shed innocent blood. Jesus taught, and he said about this commandment, hearing the leaders of his day threatening to stone a woman to death, Jesus said, if any one of you is without sin, let him cast the first stone. Jesus was against it. God is against it. Taking another person's life is really, really violating the human race, which is the image of God. Number seven, no adultery. This is one of the Ten Commandments. And so in Exodus chapter 20, verse 14, God said, you shall not commit adultery. Now, I need for you to pay close attention here, because most of the time when people read this, they're thinking that this is only for marriages. This is not only for marriages. What's the principle here? The principle is that God values faithfulness and sexual purity. God values that. What does this mean? Marriage vows made before God should be kept in spite of difficulties. Listen, if you're single out there, premarital sex is considered adultery. Now, I know this is an old school message, but I think we got to bring these into the congregation every so often. And I appreciate the grace of God, but I think God cares for us so much that He's given us commandments. He's given us laws, because when we violate these laws, there's consequences for it. Will God forgive you? He'll forgive you. He'll forgive you 10 out of 10 times, 70 times 7, He'll forgive you. However, it does not mean that we escape the consequences of the violations. And so breaking this vow is not just sinning against God, but it's sinning against your own body. In the Bible, God considers unfaithfulness to Him with adultery. Jesus taught about it in Matthew chapter 5, verse 32. He says, "I'll tell you that anyone who divorces his wife, except for sexual immorality, makes her the victim of adultery. And anyone who marries a divorced woman commits adultery." Now, this got the attention when Jesus said that, because they were used to the Jewish law. And the Jewish law had allowed a man to divorce his wife for any reason. But Jesus' teaching shocked the disciples when He told them, if anybody divorces his wife except for sexual immorality. Whoa, that narrowed down on when a divorce is approved by God. But before that, the law was you can divorce your wife for any reason. Jesus forgave the woman who had been caught in adultery. Jesus told her that no one condemned her, and He said, go and sin no more. Listen to me. You're forgiven if you have broke this commandment. But we got to catch what Jesus did after He forgives. He says, you're forgiven, but go and don't do it again. Sin no more. Okay, number 8. Do not steal. In Exodus chapter 20, verse 15, it says, you shall not steal. What's the principle here? Well, the principle is God values productivity. He values integrity. He values generosity. What does this mean? Respect other people's possessions. That's what this means. In the Bible, Paul the Apostle wrote to the Ephesians, telling them to stop stealing and to start working for their money. The prophet Malachi said that not bringing in your full tithe to the church is considered stealing. What did Jesus have to teach about this? Well, when we steal, we don't trust God's provision. And this is why Jesus said, therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothes? You see, in Jesus's eyes, Jesus pretty much was saying, listen, man, when you don't trust in God's provision, you're going to get caught up in this thing called worry. And when you're caught up in worry, then it makes people make bad decisions. Number 9, do not lie. Do not lie. Exodus chapter 20, verse 16 says, you shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. What's the principle here? God is truth and He values honesty. What does this mean? Lying can also take the form of gossip, false accusations, blame, and self-deceit. In the Bible, I love this verse. It says, those who speak the truth are valued by kings. Jesus taught about it. What was His teaching? Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come to the Father except through me. Do not lie. When you lie about people, you can destroy their lives. When you gossip about people, you can destroy their marriage. When you give false accusation about people, you can destroy their integrity and their trust, which take years to get back through people, because that's why James talks about this tongue that has the power to destroy and power to give life. Please do not lie about people. And number 10, The 10th and final commandment is do not covet. Exodus 20 verse 17 says, you shall not covet. What's the principle here? Well, God values humility. He values contentment, and he wants you to be at peace with what you have in your life. Yes, God wants to give you more, and he will give you more. But don't break a commandment over it. Do not covet. What does this mean? It means to be content with what we have. Don't allow earthly things to fill a void that only God can fill. So in the Bible, you got to remember that King Saul was jealous of David. He was jealous of David's success, and he coveted the respect that David had. He coveted the praise and the favor that David was receiving. But this is what led to King Saul's downfall. Do not covet. Jesus taught, and he said, a man's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions. I close with this. This was a mouthful that was given to you. You replay, you rewind, you go over these commandments and set them as a standard for your life. But here's what I'll close and I'll leave you with. What's the difference between then and now? With Jesus giving the example of the Good Samaritan, the summary of this interpretation would be Jesus encouraging people to live by the spirit of the law rather than the letter of the law. You remember that's how we opened up? Live by the spirit of the law rather than the letter of the law. Jesus wanted to make sure that people understood why we obey a commandment. Paul wrote that with Christ, the law is no longer written on tablets of stone, but is written on our hearts. The reason we break a commandment stems from what is in our hearts. Today, people are to drive within a speed limit. Why is that? Because speeding is dangerous to ourselves and to other drivers, and lawmakers value life. For this reason, driving faster than the speed limit is against the law. There are 10 laws that I shared with you today, and they are given with a reason that hangs from each law. It's not to control you, but it's to care for you. It's not to loot over your life, but it's to love in your life. Remember that. That's what these laws are for. And so I pray, we'll never be perfect, but this puts a standard of lifestyle for each and every one of us. So I pray you take this to heart, and it becomes your heart, and you will prosper, and you will succeed, and you will advance, and you will be able to fly with wings as eagles when we get these standards in our life and say, this is how I choose to live my life as a servant of God and as a representative of Jesus Christ. I choose this day whom I will serve, and for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. So God bless you, and I pray blessings over your life. Father, I pray for everybody watching right now. Lord, I know this was fast, it was quick, it was sudden, and it was a mouthful. But I wanted to make sure that not one of these commandments were skipped and missed. And so I pray, Lord, right now for those who are watching, I come against condemnation, Lord, because I'm sure everybody watching here has broken one of these commandments, and possibly all of them or a few. But I pray right now that they would know that there is no more condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. But I pray, Lord, that they would not use that as an excuse to continue to live a life that is not pleasing in your eyes. I pray power to come upon them, faith to come back into their life, and that honor to serve you would come back into their hearts if it's been lost. I pray that you keep them In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen and amen. You guys, listen, I'm going to see you next week. I'm going to see you on my birthday if you show up. But Sunday, church on the lawn, I can't wait for that. We're going to go out with this powerful song called Tomorrow by the Winans.
Jesus said, here I stand, won't you please let me in? And you said, I will tomorrow. Jesus said, I am he who supplies all your needs. And you said, I know.
Yo! It's time to make a change.